إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. زين للناس حب الشهوات من النساء والبنين والقناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة والخيل المسومة والأنعام والحرث، ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا والله عنده حسن المآب. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: حبب إلي من دنياكم ثلاث: النساء والطيب، وجعلت قرة عيني في الصلاة، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honorable ulama ikram, respected brothers and elders, if we have to do some soul searching and analyze our lives, we will safely arrive at the conclusion that sin dominates virtue. If we do some soul searching, we will safely arrive at the conclusion that sin dominates virtue. But that's not all. The little good that we seldom do, more than often, unfortunately, is contaminated by a host of factors. Hence, typically, you will find a person doing a good thing, but unfortunately for the wrong reason. To use a different metaphor, if we look at the type of food that we consume, the unhealthy food is much more than the healthy food. And the little healthy, supposedly healthy food is also destroyed in the manner in which we cook it, which destroys the proteins and the vitamins of what we consume. Take for example, Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a person who goes out to work and earn, man kharaja yas'a ala awladihi as-sighar fa huwa fi sabilillah, he's going to earn and provide for his family. The Nabi of Allah says, when he leaves his house and he's in the marketplace and he's earning and trading, he's in the path of Allah, he's doing something noble. But then the Nabi of Allah says, there are many people who venture into business but for the wrong reasons. So the item per se is noble, but the reason is wrong. وَمَنْ خَرَجَ رِيَاءً وَمُفَاخَرَةً فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. On the contrary, the one who comes out daily to work, not to provide, Allah has given him sufficient provision, but rather to maintain a prestigious image in society. That society understands constantly, I'm an affluent man, and I'm a wealthy person. So to preserve this image, he goes out to work. He's doing the right thing for the wrong reason. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. He's not in the path of Allah, he's in the path of the devil. Let us look, for example, the institution of marriage. A sacred bond indeed. A sacred bond indeed. Unfortunately today, the motivating factor behind marriage is only lust. One cannot deny it has an angle of lust. There is some tie towards lust. And statistics prove that lust can only sustain a third of the relation. Can only sustain a third of the relation. And to give it a time frame, 2 years. 2 years. After that they say, we need to spice up the relation. And unfortunately, the spices available, sometimes they burn the relation more than help the relation. Those are the terminologies that they use. Today you ask a person, you're getting married, he will say, but can there be any other reason behind marriage other than lust? Well, let me then open it up to you and tell you what your Nabi has said. ثَلَاثَةٌ حَقٌّ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَوْنُهُمْ. Allah takes the responsibility of perpetually aiding three people. الْمُكَاتَبُ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ الْأَدَى. A debtor who is determined to settle his debts. مَنْ أَخَذَ أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ يُرِيدُ أَدَاءَهَا أَدَّ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. Whoever takes the wealth of people passionately to pay it back. Mukatab actually refers to a slave who earns his freedom. But in present-day terminology, perhaps the simplest for understanding purposes would be that of a debtor. He borrows money and he wants to pay it. Nabi alayhi salam says, Allah will make divine arrangements for him to pay. Allah's help is with such a person. Number two, النَّاكِحُ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ الْعَفَفُ. That groom, that bride, that newlywed who gets married with the sole object of preserving their chastity. And it is as a absent of this reason, because this is not the reason in our marriage. This is not one of the driving factors. Hence you find people get married and they still remain unchaste and immoral. Why? Because that's not the driving factor behind my marriage. So infidelity is still part of his marriage. Never mind giving her a carnation of flowers on 14 February. To those of us that are not married, let me open it up to you. I swear by Allah, leave the Kruger end and leave drape in the hall. You want to give your wife the best gift? Let her know on the first night you're not a demo model. Let her know you're not a used vehicle. Give her your morality, give her your fidelity, give her your integrity and give her your virginity. And if she gives you the same, leave the world, you have exchanged the best. If she has given you integrity and you have given her integrity, I salute you, I swear by Allah, you've given her everything, even if you haven't put a ring on her finger, never mind a bangle on her hand. So what does the Nabi of Allah say? An-nakihu alladhi yuridul afa. That person who gets married with the intention of preserving his chastity, Allah's help is with such a person. Thalathatun lahum ajran. For three people, they are dual reward. Rajulun amana bi nabiyhi wa amana bi Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A person who seen the era of Isa, accepted Christianity, considered him as the greatest of human, and then lived into the era of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in accordance to the injunction of the Injil, then accepted Islam, which in essence was a culmination to his faith. And now he reveres the personality of the Nabi, of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to be the greatest. So he followed the teachings of the previous religions up until he seen the era. When he seen Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then according to the injunctions of the Injil, he had to now accept Islam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, everybody else that is a Muslim has one reward, this man has dual reward. Second person, Rajulun Abdun Mamluk Alladhi Adda Haqqa Allahi wa Haqqa Mawalihi, who is loyal and faithful to his master, a slave, and at the same time is obedient and complies to the orders of Allah. So in his obligation to his creator doesn't make him unmindful of his duty towards his master. Nabi alayhi salam says for him is dual reward. Third person, kanat lahu amatun, a man who had a slave girl. We know in Islam when a person had a slave girl, he could enjoy conjugal relation with her. But what did this man do for whom the Nabi of Allah assigns two rewards? Kanat lahu amatun fa'ajjabaha fa'ahsana ta'tibaha wa'allamaha fa'ahsana ta'limaha. He educated her and subhanallah, he gave her the best education. He molded her and he gave her the best of teachings. Thumma a'taqaha, then he set her free. Fatazawwajaha, and then he got married to her. So now look at the beauty of this man. He enjoyed conjugal relation with this woman while she was a slave. But what he did was he dignified her. He promoted her self-esteem. It's not that when she was his slave girl, he had no benefit. No, he enjoyed it. He had all the privileges. But he promoted the esteem of this woman. He honored the position of this woman. And then he took her into his nikah. Nabi alayhi salam says, you get married is one reward. He gets married is two rewards for him. And the Nabi of Allah practically did this here. If you look at his honorable consort, Juwayriya radiallahu anha, on the occasion of Bani al-Mustalif, when the spoils of the war and the prisoners were being distributed, then there was a woman by the name of Juwayriya, imra'atun hulwatun mallahatun la yaraha ahad illa akhadat bi nafsihi. A woman with phenomenal beauty, whom Allah had blessed with great beauty, and she was very attractive in her approach. Anyone seeing her would be captured. So she came in the share. She was also captured among the prisoners, and she was allotted to a sahabi by the name of Thabit ibn Qais ibn Shammas radiallahu anhu. And he then made her mukatib, which in essence entails that you give me X amount of money and you purchase your freedom. So you work, earn so much money, give it to me, and thereafter you're free. The Quran speaks about this here. وَالَّذِينَ يَبْتَغُونَ الْكِتَابَ مِمَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا. Among the many avenues where Islam exhorts us for people to earn their freedom, Islam says if a slave comes to you and says, I'm ready to negotiate a package, give you so much money, set me free. Islam says, if you see goodness in this person, that he will earn and he will become an asset to society, then release him. And then Allah implores the general masses, help him to settle that debt so he can earn his freedom. So this woman comes to Nabi alayhi salam, Ya Rasulullah, ana bintul Harith, Sayyidu Qawmihi. I am the daughter of Harith, my father Harith, who was the leader of his tribe. وَقَدْ أَصَابَنِي مِنَ الْبَلَايَا مَا لَمْ يَخْفَ عَلَيْكَ. And I've been afflicted with difficulties which are not hidden from you. فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى كِتَابَتِي. How about assisting me in settling my debt? How about assisting me in settling my debt? Nabi alayhi salam looked at her and he said, what about if I give you a better proposal? She said, go for it. What is it, O Nabi of Allah? Nabi salam said, I settle the entire debt, earn your freedom, and then take you in my nikah. She said, O Nabi of Allah, if you do that, I will be totally happy. Nabi alayhi salam arranges, pays that sahabi. She earns her freedom and then he performs his nikah to this woman and she comes into the wedlock of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And subhanallah, let me just digress for a moment and tell you love. Today whatever is happening is lust, it's not love. This is not love, brothers. Love is something beyond, this is lust. When this woman came into the wedlock of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then all her relatives which were prisoners also in the hands of sahaba, immediately they paused for a moment and they said, you know what? I got this woman's brother in my custody. Now he's the brother-in-law of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I can't keep him, I release him now. فَلَقَدْ أَعْتَقَ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهَا on that one day when this woman, Aisha radiallahu anha, said, I haven't seen a woman with more barakat. She came in the wedlock of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and hundreds of her family members got free just because now they form in-laws to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anha said, Zuffuni, Zuffuni, get me married, get me married. People said to who? He said, Binti Ali, I want to get married to the daughter of Ali radiallahu anhu. People asked why. He said, get me married. His daughter was Umme Kulthum radiallahu anha, and there was a great age gap between this woman and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. Many, many years, 20, 30, even more years of age gap. And then he proposes and he gets married, and then he tells the people, do you know what motivated me behind this marriage? One factor. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَنْقَطِعُ كُلَّ سَبَبٍ وَنَسَبٍ إِلَّا سَبَبِي وَنَسَبِي. That on the day of Qiyamah and at death, all forms of relation and ties are severed. But anyone who is related to me and his family to me, that will avail him even after his death. I tried to make inroads into the family of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was to get married to the daughter of Ali so that I can secure this bond for me. And he said, 40,000 dirhams will be mahar. And he also said, I do have one honor, and that is I'm the father-in-law of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My daughter is married, but I thought I secure it from a dual angle and I get married to the granddaughter of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hence, these are some of the reasons. These are some of the reasons that a Muslim should have and aspire to when getting married. Today, brothers, when a couple gets married, the house is found. The only thing required now is to make a home. But believe me, even after the house is found, they cannot make a home. And when we look previously, our parents, our elders, our seniors, our ancestors, when they got married, there was no house, no home. But they united and Allah gave them both. Allah gave them a house also and Allah gave them a home. Today the house is found, but the home cannot be made, which is so simple. Every person is passionate to enhance his relation. And come the period that we are passing, once again, it arouses these aspirations, given the exposure that we have. This is a very, very big fitna, this 14th February. You know, I was speaking to the children in the madrasa. Those children that are sitting in school and they receive these presents, many of them feel left out. Someone told me this, it might sound like a joke, but I don't know how true it is. He said, I decided to send myself some flowers. Because I felt left out. I mean, nobody likes me. Nobody has feeling for me. Nobody has concern for me. So I decided to send a carnation of flowers for myself and enjoy a sense and deceive the world. This is what it entails. Let's look from the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, both physically and spiritually, at avenues and methods that will enhance our relation. What was the noble life of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came home? It comes in the riwayat, Shuraih ibn Hani says, I asked Aisha radiallahu anha, بِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ كَانَ يَبْدَأُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ إِذَا دَخَلَ بَيْتَهُ. When he entered at home, what was the first thing he did? She said, قَالَتْ بِالسِّوَاكِ. He would enter, make salam, and then use his miswak. The commentators write, amongst the wisdoms of this was, that he was very particular when he comes close to his wife, he doesn't give her an offensive smell. Then his entire body was unique. Sahaba say we used to gather his perspiration and we used to use it as itar. Can you imagine how beautiful the smell from his blessed lips was? But what precautions did my Nabi take? What precautions? I implore you, my brother, leave that gift and give up smoking on behalf of my sister, I ask you. When you come close to her, have pity for her. What were the teachings of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam? She wants to come close to you, but then we have the evil habit of smoking. Now in present day terminology, they'll talk of counseling and psychology. They won't tell you give up smoking, they'll say hook her on to cigarettes also. So then she's got nothing to argue about. That is how the present day mentality is working. I swear by Allah, that is how they think. You listen to the media, read the papers, this is how they operate. Not give up smoking so at least my wife can have a pleasant smell when I can. No. Hook her on to cigarettes and she can't complain. You can't complain. Together you could live life. But that is not the teachings of Nabi alayhi salam. Kana yabda'u bis siwak. He would commence so that when he would come close, Aisha radiallahu anha says, Kana yuqabbiluni wa huwa sa'im. His blessed lips used to come on my blessed body even while he was fasting. He would never leave without kissing me. Have we studied the social life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That's not all. The riwayat of Bukhari. Nabi alayhi salam said, إِذَا سَقَطَتْ لُقْمَةُ أَحَدِكُمْ. When your muscle falls down, pick it up. وَلَا يَدَعْهَا فَلْيُمِتْ مَا كَانَ بِهَا مِنْ أَذَنْ. Remove the dirt that has settled on that muscle. وَلْيَأَكُلْهَا and eat it. وَلَا يَدَعْهَا لِلشَّيْطَانِ. And do not leave it for the devil to eat it. Then he said, فَلَا يَمْسَحْ يَدَهُ حَتَّى يَلْعَقَهَا أَوْ يُلْعِقَهَا. Don't wipe your fingers after you have eaten. Perhaps the barakat be on the food particles on your fingers. So what you do is either lick it yourself or have someone to lick it. What did he say? lick it yourself or have someone else to lick it? Imam Nawawi rahmatullah says it is obvious who can be referred to in that someone other than his wife. I don't wish to be obscene, brothers, forgive me, but I think how long will I hide the reality? Today you tell someone by lick your wife's fingers, he says no, that is unhygienic. And then they ask him permission to do that same action somewhere else. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Allah save one and all. Allah save one and all. It's unhygienic to, but that's what the Nabi did. And that is what will secure joy. But what are we exposed to and what are we doing and how is this messing our marriages up? That is not all. He comes home. He says, Aisha, udni minni, come close to me. I said, ana haid, but I'm experiencing my menstrual cycle. He said, that's not a problem. Look your dress. He placed his blessed head on my lap and he started reading the Quran until he fell off to sleep. Maymunah radiallahu anha says, whenever he came home, he slept with me. There wasn't a time. In fact, he was so passionate, even if he wanted to spend the night in ibadat, he would never deprive me of his closeness. He will jump in the bed, talk to me, and when he would perceive I have fallen off to sleep, he will stand up and perform salah. His spiritual obligation never made him oblivious to his duty to his wife. Today we're playing table tennis and we're playing pool and we phone the wife, I can't come, and she sleeps innocently. And then we want to want justification and we want happiness in our marriages. What are we talking? Aisha radiallahu anha says, kunna naghtasilu min ina'in wahid. You know what? Myself and him used to bath from one vessel. Fayubadiruni wa ana ubadiruhu. The Nabi of Allah on one side and I'm on one side. And then I used to take water, I used to hasten to scoop and he used to hasten to scoop. And then he used to tell me, da'ili, and I used to say, da'ali. Oh, Nabi of Allah, you're taking the water too quick. And I used to say, you're taking it too quick. She said, we used to casually talk like this. And this is how we used to shower, and this is how we used to bath. This is the beautiful teachings of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But how much time? Ya Aish, he used to refer to her in Aish, which is an abbreviation, to show his love, to show his bond, to show his contact. This is how he interacted with his wives. So we have to look into our life. Amongst his wives, there was so much casual relation. Aisha radiallahu anha said, one day I was sitting with Hafsa, and then Sauda radiallahu anha came, one of the other wives. Now, little rivalry amongst the co-wives is accepted. Anyway, never mind co-wife, you just speak to your wife about one woman that you knew. And then you see what happens. You know, by Muslim, the best part of it is, when you answer the phone, I knew you were speaking to a woman. How do you know? I said, but I could make out from your tone. I could make out from your tone. You're very polite and gentle and passive. Subhanallah, if Allah gives us that to speak with our own wife, you'll see what these marriages will see. But unfortunately, we tone down passive with strange women. And with our own wife, we're arrogant, we're harsh, we're abrupt. And then we want joy, we want happiness. It's time we reanalyze the objectives of our marriage. So what happens here? Sauda and Aisha and Hafsa are sitting together. Sauda comes very beautifully dressed. The riwayat Abu Ya'la makes mention of the narration. She comes very beautiful dressed. So Hafsa radiallahu anha says, Yaji'u Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa hadhihi tabruqu bainana. The Nabi of Allah is coming in. She's looking very smart today and she's looking very attractive. La'ufsidanna alayha zinataha. I'm going to cause it for her. So Aisha said, leave her alone. I mean, she's beautiful. Leave her. Whatever. Why are you getting? She said, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to show it. So anyway, they started chatting. So Sauda said, ma taqulna. What are you people saying? She said, what are we saying? You beautifying yourself. Kharaj al-a'war. Kharaj al-a'war. Dajjal has appeared. She said, really? فَفَزِعَتْ فَزْعًا شَدِيدًا. She got hysterical and I'm beautifying myself. Dajjal has made his appearance. So what must I do? She said, عَلَيْكِ بِالْخَيْمَةِ. Go hide yourself there quickly. It's not nice to be like this. So she went into this tent here. وَكَانَ فِيهَا نَسِيجَ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ وَالْقَذِرَاتِ. There was dirt. It was haunted. It was deserted. And she went inside and these two were laughing. It comes in the hadith. لا تستطيعاني أن تتكلم من الضحك. They couldn't speak because of excessive laughter. They are laughing non-stop. The Nabi of Allah walks in. He says, مَذِّحْكُ. What's the reason of laughing? No answer. They are laughing. What's the reason of laughing? No answer. Now you walk in and your wife is she's laughing and you say, I said, why are you laughing? Can I have an answer here, please? Who am I talking? Am I talking to the walls? It comes in the riwayat, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked three times, no answer. فَأَوْمَآ إِلَى الْخَيْمَةِ. They said, look in that tent and you'll know everything. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam goes to the tent. Subhanallah, what a Nabi. He went that close in Mi'raj that Jibreel could not journey beyond him, but he dropped himself in his social life that even you and I don't have time to do what he did with his family. When he went in, said, فَإِذَا هِيَ تُرْعِدْ. She was shivering. Nabi Sassam asked her, Sauda, what's wrong? She said, خَرَجَ الْأَعْوَرْ. Oh, Nabi of Allah, Dajjal has made his presence. Nabi Sassam said, Sauda, where did you hear that from? Who told you this now, Sauda? لَا يَخْرُجُونَ. He'll come out on his time. Then they came out, they hugged one another, and then they cleaned Sauda radiallahu anha. Brothers, this was one aspect. Let me show you the other aspect of spirituality in his relation. Ibn Umar comes to my mother Aisha and she says, tell me something unique about him. So my mother says, what wasn't unique in his life? What wasn't? But let me tell you one particular incident. One day he came home and then he jumped into the bed. Hatta lasiqa jilduhu bijildi. His blessed flesh touched on my skin. I cried when I read this hadith and I said, Subhanallah, what an honor to Aisha. What a privilege to Aisha. She says, the Nabi of Allah jumped in bed, his blessed feet on my feet, his blessed hands on my hands. She said in the hadith, you know, I spoke about it last week, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his fatal illness, she said when he became sick, then what I did was, I started reading Surah Falaq and Surah Nas. And after that, we take our hands and we blow it and we, you know, gently pass it over the body. She said, I read Falaq and Nas, but I said, how can I use on my hands on his body? So I read Falaq and Nas and I took his hand and used it on his own body. Because I said, these are the blessed hands. These are the real hands that have everything. So I read Surah Falaq and Nas and I took his own hand and then I passed it on his body. Anyway, he jumped into the bed. Then he said, Aisha, dharini ata'abbadu li rabbi. Aisha, give me some time. I want to speak to my Allah. I want to speak to my Allah. So what did Aisha say? Subhanallah. You know, like this brother told me, say, I asked my wife, I'm going for 40 days in Jamaat. Do you mind? She said, you can go. He said, right, I know. You can go. What did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? She said, Aisha radiallahu anha said, وَلَكِنْ أُحِبُّ قُرْبَكْ وَأُحِبُّ أَن تَتَعَبَّدَ رَبَّكْ. I don't want you to leave me and I don't want to deny you the moments with your Lord. What does it come in the story of? Dawood alayhi salam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the four hikmat of Dawood. An intelligent man is, حَقٌ لِلْآقِلِ أَن تَكُونَ لَهُ أَرْضَعُ سَاعَاتٍ. Brothers, give me some time. Bear with me. I will end, inshallah. حَقٌ لِلْعَاقِلِ أَن تَكُونَ أَرْبَعَ سَاعَاتٍ. A sign of intellect in a man is that he has four moments in his life. سَاعَةٌ يُنَاجِي فِيهَا رَبَّهُ. A moment daily where he communicates with his Allah. سَاعَةٌ يُحَاسِبُ فِيهَا نَفْسَهُ. A moment where he does some soul searching and introspects. سَاعَةٌ يَخْلُو فِيهَا بِأَصْحَابِهِ الَّذِينَ يُخْبِرُونَهُ بِعُيُوبِهِ. A moment where he confides and socializes with his friends, who can help him identify his wrongs so that he can improve himself. وَسَاعَةٌ يَخْلُو فِيهَا بِلَذَّتِهِ فِيمَا يَحِلُّ. And a moment where he satisfies his needs and his desires within the parameters of Shariat. That is a sign of an intelligent man. So Aisha radiallahu anha said, O Nabi of Allah, I don't mind, but if you want to stand up. Nabi alayhi salam says, she says he stood up, he then performed wudu, and then he started performing salah. حَتَّى بَلَّ لِحْيَتُهُ. He sat with me casually, made jokes with me, laughed with me, entertained me. But then came another phase in his life and he stood up, he left the closed bed. I swear by Allah, the ummah is desperate for this year. This is what we need in the dead of night. He cried till his blessed beard became wet. He went into sajda, hatta ballal ard. The earth became wet. Bilal came and pet him and he said, enough. He said, you know what Bilal, Allah revealed to me in this portion of the night. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Verily in the change of night and day, there are great signs for men to reflect. وَيْلٌ لِمَنْ قَرَأَهَا وَلَمْ يَتَفَكَّرْ بِهَا. Woe be to those who read this but are negligent about it. So moments also in our relation together to turn towards Allah. I leave you with an incident, perhaps you heard it, time doesn't spare me. Very briefly, I run you through this incident. The famous Sahabi Sa'd radiallahu anhu, who comes to the Nabi of Allah, what should be the motivating factor behind marriage? That is what's going to sustain the relation if there is correct, if there's some patience. Today, unfortunately, we lack it. One doctor told me a nice thing. He says, Mawlana, the patients don't have patience today. What happened? Sa'd radiallahu anhu comes to Nabi alayhi salam. Ya Rasulallah, ayamna'uni sawadi wa damamata wajhi min dukhuli al-jannah. I am dark skinned and I don't have physical beauty. Will this deprive me of entry into Jannah? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, never, Sa'd. That is not how Allah will judge you and analyze you. He said, O Nabi of Allah, but then I must be honest with you. I've proposed to everyone. فَرَدُّونِي لِسَوَادِ. They have declined my proposal because of my complexion. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pet him and then said, هَلْ شَهِدَ الْيَوْمَ عَمْرِ بْنِ وَهَبْ. Tell me, did Amr ibn Wahab come today? كَانَ قَرِيبَ الْعَهْدِ بِالْإِسْلَامِ. Who had accepted Islam very recently, but he had handed himself totally to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَتَعْرِفُ مَنْزِلَهُ. You know his house? اِذْهَبْ. Go to his house. وَقْرَعِ الْبَابَ قَرْعًا رَقِيقًا. Politely knock on the door. When the man comes out, greet him. And then tell him, قَدْ زَوَّجَنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَتَاتَكُمْ. The Nabi of Allah has said that he got me married to your daughter. He says, I got happy and I came to the house. I knocked on the door. سَمِعُوا لُغَةً عَرَبِيَّ. They realized it was an Arab at the door. They welcomed him. When they seen his appearance, somehow they developed the sense of reservation. He says, the Nabi of Allah has sent me and he's told me that I must get married to your daughter whose name was Atika. وَكَانَ لَهَا حَظٌّ مِّنَ الْجَمَالِ وَالْعَقْلِ. A woman of intellect, a woman of beauty. She had everything. So the father looked at this, he said, I wasn't fully convinced. He said, no. I don't think I will get my daughter married to you. The Sahabi accepted and politely he left. The daughter heard the discussion. The daughter said, Ya Abata An-Najat, An-Najat, قَبْلَ أَن يَفْضَحَكَ الْوَحْيُ. Oh my father, pause for a moment. Don't hasten and decline before revelation exposes you. فَإِنْ يَكُوا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قَدْ زَوَّجَنِي فَقَدْ رَضِيتُ بِمَا رَضِيَ اللَّهُ لِي وَرَسُولُهُ. If this is the proposal extended by Allah's Nabi, I am more than happy with his choice in my favor. There could be nothing like wealth. This man was a pauper. There could be nothing like beauty. He lacked apparent beauty. What could be the motivating factor behind this marriage other than compliance to the orders of Allah and his Nabi? The Sahabi comes away to Nabi alayhi salam, cutting a long story short. The father comes running after he had a chat with his daughter. Today my sister openly says, I don't want a bearded man. And my brother says, I don't want a scarf woman. Then I beg you, don't beg, knock our doors when there's crisis in your marriage. When you tell me, I want a moderate woman. I don't want a person that is a scarf, and I don't want a man that is bearded. Then don't ask, why do we knock the doors of ulama at that time? When we see crisis in our marriages. He comes and he sits down. The Nabi of Allah tells him, أَنْتَ الَّذِي رَدَتَّ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مَا رَدَتَّ. I send this proposal and you decline. He said, oh Nabi of Allah, forgive me. I wasn't convinced that it came from you. All misunderstanding cleared. But here's my daughter. You can take her in the nikah of this young boy. Nabi alayhi salam tells this boy, okay, go and get your mehr and get married. He said, oh Nabi of Allah, وَالَّذِي بَعْثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ نَبِيًّا. I don't have a cent in my house. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, okay, then go. Today we delay in the marriage because the cook is not available. The hall is not available. Here the Nabi of Allah is making arrangements when he hasn't got dowry also. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, go to Uthman, he'll give you 200. Again, you know, food for thought for the wealthy of this ummah. There were certain wealthy people whose wealth was at the disposal of Nabi alayhi salam. He could send 100 people. All they needed to know, they came from the Nabi of Allah. No question asked. They gave more than what was asked. Where are the wealthy of this ummah upon whom their wealth can be accepted for the deen of Allah? Allah provides you with the added platform. Seize the opportunity before Allah takes what he has given you. He goes to Uthman, he gives him 200 and more. He goes to Umar, he goes to Ali radiallahu anhu, he gives him 200. He goes to Abdurrahman ibn Auf, they give him 200. He takes this wealth, he comes in the bazaar. As he's walking to buy something from his wife, the call comes out. An-nafir, an-nafir, ya khaylallahi irkabi. The Jamaat is going in jihad. Come, who is ready to join this expedition? He pauses for a moment, he glances. And he says, Allah, what do I do? Clash of emotions, my wife, my aspiration. He said, Allah, I will invest this money where you will be happy. Leave the trousseau and the rings and the jewelry. Fashtara saif, and he buys a horse. Wastara farasan, he buys a sword. And he takes this, he goes into the battlefield. My brother, today, when you will be in your hall, I swear by Allah, the caller won't call jihad. Yes, the muazzin will call out. The muazzin will call out. Disturb and adjust it and respond. And I hope from Allah that if you will respond to that Isha Salah on the Saturday night of your wedding, or that Zohar Salah on the Sunday afternoon, or the Fajr Salah when you are reclining at some beach at a scenic view, Allah will give you the same reward that he gave this man for responding to jihad. He goes into the battle. The Nabi of Allah sees him. Nabi Sassan says, are you sad? He says, yes, O Nabi of Allah. He advances. Someone calls out, he has been martyred. The Nabi of Allah comes, lifts his head, فَوَضَعَهُ عَلَىٰ حِجْرِهِ, then places it on his lap, and then pets him and he says, مَا أَتْيَبَ رِيحَكْ. How beautiful you are smelling, how wonderful your fragrance is, how the angels are fighting over you. He looks at him, he smiles, he cries, he turns his face, and he says, I swear by Allah, he has already arrived at my pond waiting for me to give him water. One sahabi said, what is this you smile and crying and turn? He said, I cried because I miss him. I'm happy because what Allah gave him, and I turned my face. فَإِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَزْوَاجَهُ مِنَ الْحُورِ الْعِينِ يَتَبَادَرْنَهُ كَاشِفَاتٍ سُوقَهُنْ. I seen the woman running to fight over him, and in the process, the calf got exposed. فَأَعْرَضْتُ عَنْهُنَّ حَيَاءً. I turned my face out of respect and modesty that this woman belongs to him. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, take his sword and take his horse. Give it to that woman and tell her Allah gave him a better woman in Jannah. We call upon the youth of this day. As I said, Allah is not going to ask you to respond to jihad. I'm asking you, honor the sentiments of Allah. Allah will give you joy in this world and in the akhirah. I have time, I can explore and run onto this topic. For Allah's sake, don't give that Valentine gift. Let me beg you, let me cry. I wish I could pour my heart out with the sentiments that is in my heart. My heart cries tears of blood. Ya Allah, why is this ummah? When I see children coming openly violating the order of Allah, I held the hand of that child. I said, why have you cut your hair, mushroom, my brother? What can I do, Malana? I love it. I beg you, brothers, it's time we honor Allah for us, for Allah to bring joy in our marriages. May Allah Ta'ala bring happiness and barakat in our marriages and give us the ability to institute measures that will enhance our relation and bring us closer to Allah. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.